Hello and welcome to our program. Serbia is a country that can trace its history back to the Neolithic age or almost 9 centuries. But as a modern republic, it is young and dynamic. India has always shared a warm friendship with Serbia. And today we are delighted to have with us on our program the ambassador of Serbia to India, His Excellency, Mr. Vladimir Maric. Mr. Maric, welcome to the program.
Delighted to be here. Thank you for having me.
First of all, greetings on Serbia Day. There's a special significance to it, isn't it?
That's right. We're celebrating what we call our statehood day.
Statehood day.
Which is the national day of Serbia on the 15th of February every year to commemorate the adoption of the first modern constitution of Serbia.
Now, Serbia is in a very interesting state of affairs because it traces its history back to 900 years and yet 9 centuries, and yet it is so modern and so young. What is the sense of history that Serbians feel?
I want to mention the fact that Serbia is the legal successor state of former Yugoslavia.
Absolutely.
Which is an entity which is very well known to the Indian audience, to the Indian people. For several reasons. The first of these reasons being the fact that former Yugoslavia, erstwhile Yugoslavia, and India were among the founding members of the Non-Aligned Movement.
Absolutely, and Josip Broz Tito's friendship with Pandit Nehru is legendary, isn't it?
That's right, absolutely. Out of this friendship that you mentioned came the Non-Aligned Movement. Mm-hmm. The first summit of this movement took place in 1961 in Belgrade. The friendship was long-lasting between Prime Minister Nehru and President Tito. One of the things that we still enjoy to present day because of this friendship is the embassy location, which is in the best place in Chanakyapuri, the diplomatic area of New Delhi. We are trying to do here as the Serbian embassy and myself as the Serbian ambassador is to make the Indian people, the Indian friends, aware of this connection between former Yugoslavia and Serbia. You know, when I say I'm the ambassador of Serbia, people would say, oh, Siberia, it's very cold and so on and so on. And then I would have to start explaining, and I often start off with this, that actually Serbia is a successor state of former Yugoslavia, that the capital of Serbia, Belgrade, used to be the capital of former Yugoslavia, that President Tito was buried in Belgrade, that he chose to be buried in Belgrade even though he was a Croat by nationality. And then people put us in the right context.
This friendship that President Tito and Prime Minister Nehru shared What is it like today?
Political relations between India and Serbia, even today, are as good as they can be between
any
two countries.
Serbia has supported India's bid for the UN seat.
That's right, and India is supporting us on a whole host of issues which are very important to us. The first one of these being the fact that India hasn't recognized the independence of Kosovo,
right,
which is a province, southern province of Serbia, which declared independence unilaterally and illegally in 2008. So obviously India has not recognized this, which we very much appreciate. As you mentioned, we also support our Indian friends whenever and in all the other international organizations where that is possible. Going back to the overall political relations, all the agreements, everything that we need is there in place, and it's been there for decades. So what we need to do all together, us here at the Serbian Embassy in India, my dear colleague, the Indian ambassador in Belgrade, the rest of the Indian diplomats in Belgrade, all of us together, our business people, our artists, our sportsmen, and so on, see how we can use the solid base which has been there for a long time to do more when it comes to the relationships between our two countries, primarily in terms of economy, trade, culture, education, sports cooperation, and so on. So even formally speaking, all the required agreements are in place, have been signed, and are there for a long time.
One of the things, of course, is trade and economy. What are the potentialities?
Nothing to stop us from increasing the volume of trade, cooperation,
right,
in terms of potential Indian investments in Serbia, use of Serbian technology in India within the Make in India campaign by Prime Minister Modi, and so on. There are a few areas of special interest. One of them is agriculture. Serbia traditionally has been a nation of agriculture with very fertile, clean, good quality soil. We produce excellent fruit and vegetable. Raspberry, for example, we produce top quality raspberry in the world, which is high value added fruit. So we're trying to tie up with Indian companies and to see what we can do in the field of agriculture. Location of Serbia is such that it is a bridge between the West and the East.
Right.
In many ways, geographically primarily, also politically, Serbia will become the next member of the European Union. Now is the right time for Indian companies to invest in Serbia before we join the European Union, so that their operations are up and running at the moment when we would be joining the European Union.
They would get the full advantage. Where are the areas that you think that Indian investment can be profitable for Serbia? What are the kind of things you're looking for?
There are several other areas. One where one Indian company has already invested,
okay,
is real estate. Embassy Group from Bangalore has already finished constructing the first phase of its IT park.
Mm-hmm.
In a town which is located about 60 kilometers north of Belgrade. And peculiarly enough, it's called the town, it's called India,
okay,
which sounds almost the same as India, and the way it's spelled also. So there's a symbolism in this as well. This is an interesting connection, real estate and IT, brilliant engineers that you have and schools and so on. So we want to see how we can expand this this cooperation in the field of the IT. Pharmaceutical industry, also one field where there's possibility for expanding cooperation and so on.
You mentioned pharmaceuticals. Now, India has been the hub center in this part of the world for medical tourism.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see any kind of cooperation there? Do you think that is the kind of tourism that can come to India from Serbia?
Absolutely. Tourism in general is one area of priority for us,
mm-hmm,
as well, in both directions. Outgoing tourism from India into Serbia and the other way around. Obviously, we are very small compared to India, so the importance the direction from India to Serbia exceeds, from our point of view, obviously, right. the number of tourists that could potentially visit India from Serbia, and the importance that these numbers would have for India, for obvious reasons of
size. Now, Serbia, so when you mentioned, mm-hmm. you know, it's a beautiful country with mountains and the sea and the beautiful monasteries and the spas, which it's famous for.
Packages that we want to offer to the Indian market would not be would not be what you would expect in the so-called mainstream industry, tourism industry, when you look at the rest of the countries in Europe. We want to offer something different. We want to offer the opportunity to Indian tourists to spend time in the countryside, to go hiking in the untouched nature, to stay and spend time with local farmers, live on their land, in their mm-hmm. houses with them, where they have their own cattle and they have their own milk and they make their own cheese and they grow their own vegetables and so on and so on. So we want this is one of the offers that we want to develop for the Indian tourists. The nature is spectacularly beautiful in Serbia. We don't have access to sea, unfortunately, anymore. But plenty of
that
of
remains
water
in the mind because you think of the larger Yugoslavia.
That's right,
whenever.
That's right. But plenty of water in Serbia, even though we don't have access to sea.
You have the beautiful Danube.
Lakes, rivers, Danube, yeah. As you're pointing out. Belgrade, the capital, is at the confluence of two rivers, Danube and Sava. So it really lies and lives on the water.
I have many different names. I have many life forms and many faces, many colors and many senses. I am fertile and abundant. I am the keeper of time. I am the source of life.
We have a huge development project called Belgrade Waterfront, which is being developed on the banks of on the riverfront right now as we speak. So this will further contribute to the appeal of Belgrade itself as a tourist destination. Although already Belgrade, as a capital of Serbia, has won the hearts and minds of the younger travelers from the EU, and I hope from India soon as well. For its exquisite nightlife.
Right.
Nightlife, which is very, very dynamic, vibrant, which includes culture, cultural shows, theater. It's very artsy, the Belgrade scene, so young people enjoy it a lot. We're still comparatively cheap. compared to the other countries in our region.
That's a big advantage, isn't it?
It is. It is. We're working on improving the connectivity. We don't have, unfortunately, direct flights right now. But still, even with the connecting flights, you can reach Belgrade in about 10 hours.
And you know, this is quite interesting what you're saying, because when one thinks of Belgrade, one thinks of a great sense of history. The White City goes back to the Neolithic age, 8,500 years ago. That is the kind of image you have. And then this is the new Belgrade you're talking about, which one is not so aware of. So there's scope yet for Indian tourists who are either looking for a sense of history or looking for the kind of the modern Belgrade that you're talking about.
Absolutely,
isn't it?
And I'm glad that you pointed this out, because Belgrade itself has the old city and the new Belgrade, which is called New Belgrade, the new part of the city across the Sava River, and all parts of Belgrade have their own charm. And I'm hoping that the Indian travelers, Indian friends, will start enjoying and feeling this soon.
The ancient and the modern coexist in Serbia, in Belgrade in particular. That's exactly how India is. You have ancient temples, little villages, cheek by jowl with modern buildings, and you know, the futuristic India all existing together. So what is the kind of tourist potential that you see for Serbians when they come to India?
It's huge, obviously, because India is one of the top destinations when it comes to tourists coming from other countries in the world, because of the wealth of heritage that it has, diversity. I've been living here for about 15 or 16 months now, and I've only seen a tiny portion of what India has to offer. So myself, I'm hoping to be able to travel more, and to you know, time flies. So 4 years that I'm supposed to be here will
what
pass
all have
quickly.
You seen so far?
Unfortunately, I came here in October 2014, the 24th of October, the day following the Diwali. I thought that would be a good day to start my mission to India, and we were blessed, my wife and I, that she got married right after we arrived to India. Okay. So we were able to visit, obviously, the Taj Mahal, and we went to Mumbai for work a couple of times. We've been to Jaipur, we've been to Kolkata. So we visited quite a few places, having in mind that we could not really travel freely.
The connection with India is now very personal and very deep. This is the country where your son came.
It is. That's right.
So it's always going to be special for you.
It is, and even more special for him, I think.
So this, I hope, again inspires a lot of Serbians to come to India.
I also want to convey the message to my Serbian friends to begin with. This is what I've been doing, that India is a developed country. It's developing, but. You know, when I was in Gurgaon for the first time, and I was sitting there in Cyber Hub, and I was looking at all these high-rise buildings, brand new, modern, and you know, you had the subway passing by. I was happy. I was happy for India. I was happy for the development that I was seeing. So this is something that I'm telling all my friends: come to India with an open heart and open mind, and you will leave a better person.
Definitely a better person. You mentioned movies and how India is portrayed in movies. Serbia itself has a very dynamic and vibrant cinema, doesn't it? But there is also has been a lot of collaboration where India and Serbia is concerned. A film has been made recently, or is it still in the process?
It's still in the Dev in the Bhumi? Process. Yes, they had shoots in Belgrade for one of the movies. Hasn't been published yet, but we are trying to advertise Serbia as a filming destination for Indian movies. For several reasons. Obviously, this is something which is good for the local movie industry, but another important point when it comes to this is that a good, successful Indian movie filmed in a foreign location is, in my opinion, the best advertisement that this country can have as a tourist destination.
Absolutely.
And I've talked to other ambassadors and people in the Indian movie industry who told me that miracles happened with other foreign countries because of the success of Indian movies which were filmed in these countries. Very good quality that you get for the low price that you're paying.
And there are so many famous film personalities, directors, actors who are known the world over. Of course, that is not our kind of cinema, but it is beautiful cinema, isn't it?
Emir Kusturica is probably the
best known
Serbian director. Goran Paskaljevic is another one who's quite present here in India. He was the president of the jury at the Goa Film Festival a couple of years ago. He was shooting a movie in places north of New Delhi, up in the mountains. It's a co-production between India and Serbia as well. I'm not sure how far that has gone. But we as Serbia and as Serbian film industry, we're more and more present in
Now this collaboration India. Is very interesting because there is this film called Devabhoomi, Abode of the Gods, which has a famous Serbian screenwriter and an Indian director in Viktor Banerjee, who's one of our very well-known actors.
There's nothing to stop us from expanding this cooperation in every way possible. And I'm sure that this is what's going to be happening. We're there to help, to facilitate this process.
How many of the Indian films have you seen?
I wish I had more time to watch Indian movies. But one interesting point when you mentioned this is I want to make sure I mention this, is that Indian series, short series, are very popular in Serbia.
That's interesting.
They're a big hit. Valika Badu.
Okay, that's interesting.
It's very popular.
And the people-to-people contact can be...
This needs to follow. We need, again, us and our counterparts on the other side in the Indian Foreign Service, we need to use this. We need to use this fact. This was not something which was done in purpose by government officials, neither from the Indian side or from the Serbian side. You know, this is one of the TV stations in Serbia that did commercially, and it's working very well for them. So I think that us, what we need to do is register this, which is what we have done, and use it for what we are doing.
I think Serbia and India have something in common: is tennis. We have of late become a force to reckon with Sania Mirza and Mahesh Bhupathi and Leander Paes in the world of tennis, and you have a history with Djokovic and Monica Seles and many of the other tennis players, one of the top countries where tennis is concerned, and other sports as well.
Serbia and the Serbian people are a nation of sports. Traditionally, we've been best at team sports.
Okay.
Team spirit is important for us in Serbia. But this phenomenon with tennis is relatively new. And it started with Novak Djokovic, who's currently number one player in the world. He's at the top of his career. It's difficult for me to see who can topple him
One Indian will one day.
I hope when it happens, it will be an Indian.
Yes, very much so.
That will manage to do that. Novak Djokovic and Serbian girls as well. Jelena Janković, Ana Ivanović, both former world number ones in tennis. We are vice champions of the world in basketball. Right. We only lost at the last world championships. We lost to the US in the finals. And I always tell people when I talk about sports, it's very easy being a Serbian ambassador when you have ambassadors such as Novak Djokovic, ambassadors of Serbia.
Or you have ambassadors who have played tennis, like you have.
Tennis is very important to me. I've been playing it since I was a kid. I've been competing as well. I'm very friendly with all these people involved with tennis in India. Leander Paes is a good friend of mine. Maybe I can use this opportunity to announce the fact that on the 16th and 17th of April, a group of ambassadors, foreign ambassadors based here in New Delhi, we will be organizing a charity diplomatic tennis tournament. The aim will be to raise as much funds as possible through donations from private companies, from corporates. And the idea is to use these funds to make one Indian village open defecation free.
Okay.
We're tying up with Sulab International, a prominent Indian NGO. which is active in this field. We're just finalizing the invitation letters that a group of the ambassadors, about 10 or 15 of us, will be signing and sending out. The tournament will be happening on the 16th and 17th of April. On 2 days, Saturday will be taking place at RK Kana Tennis Complex on Africa Avenue, and on the 17th, the finals will be happening at the Serbian Embassy.
Oh, fantastic!
Strangely enough,
Excellency, this is a wonderful initiative to adopt a village like that and to make it defecation-free. We greet you once again on Serbia Day, and thank you so much for being on our program today. And we do hope that this friendship continues.
Thank you, and I hope to see you there on the 15th.
I will. Thank you.